Welcome. I'm Pastor Craig Miller at First Alhambra Methodist. Let us open up with a word of prayer. And as we begin our prayers, let's keep in mind that at the taping of this video, we've heard that President Trump and many of his aides, as long with senators and congressmen, both Democrat and Republican, have come down with the COVID-19. So let us also include them in our prayers, along with all those who have lost a loved one during this time. Let us pray. Dear God, we think of all those who've been affected by the COVID-19. We especially lift up President Trump, the advisors that work with him. We think of senators and congresspeople, both Republicans and Democrats, who have also been affected and come down with COVID-19. We think of the million people that have been lost, the over 200,000 people have been lost in the United States. We think of all their families, all their friends, all the people that those people were connected with, and pray that you would be with them and show mercy upon them. We pray for healing for our nation and our world. Let us pray our prayer today. Dear God, give us a new story to tell, one of gratitude, love, and hope. Amen. Today we're concluding our series on Life is in the Transitions. Over the course of 7 weeks, we've taken a look at accept it, mark it, shed it, create it, share it, launch it. And today we're going to be taking a look at tell it. One of the big lessons from this book is that in order to transition from one part of our life to another, we need to be able to articulate and tell the story of what happened. That storytelling is a powerful way that we are able to share our understanding of ourselves and understanding of what has happened to us in our life. In the first lesson of our series, we talked about this template related to how to tell a story. There is the stories of overcoming, the me story, which is under the idea of agency, the belonging stories, which are the we stories, we survived, and the cause stories, the story, we change the world. We are part of something bigger than ourselves. So as I was thinking about this, I thought I'd share with you some thoughts related to some things I learned about when I was working on the book iKids in terms of our brains and how the stories that we tell and the experiences that we have are deeply embedded in our brains and our memories, and how important it is to be able to remember those and draw for them as we tell our own story. One of the terms I learned about is the connectome. Let me read this quote. Our individual identities, the person each of us is today, are summed up by all the connections we have made in our brains up to this point in our life. Sebastian Sung, author of Connectome, says, a connectome is the totality of connections between the neurons in a nervous system. The term, like a genome, implies completeness. A connectome is not one connection or even many. It is all of them. I found this to be a very interesting idea, that we are the sum of all the experiences we have had in our life up to this particular second. All the things that have happened to us complete our own connectome and our own interconnectedness. Now, in his book, Connectome, he talks about the amount of computer technology you would need to be able to map all the connections in their brain. It's almost impossible to do. But what he is pointing to is the idea that all our life experiences make us who we are today. Let's take a look at the different components of our life story. There is our birth family, our culture, our faith tradition, our K-12 brain, our life experiences, and long-term relationships. So let me break this down as we think about what is the story that we have to share to ourselves and with others. Well, first we have our birth family. Let's take a look at Joseph's birth family. Now, the sons of Jacob were 12, the sons of Leah, Reuben, Jacob's firstborn, Simeon, Levi, Judah, Issachar, and Zebulun, the sons of Rachel, Joseph and Benjamin, the sons of Bilhah, Rachel's maid, Dan and Naphtali, the sons of Zilpha, Leah's maid, Gad and Asher. These were the sons of Jacob who were born to him in Paddan Aram. So as we can see, the family of Joseph was quite complicated. There were four different women who gave birth to the children of Jacob. And all these brothers and half-brothers interacted with each other in ways that sometimes were not very healthy in terms of their interactions. So when we think about family, we must realize that our birth families are not perfect. There's many different things that go on in our lives, but the stories we tell about those experiences do impact us today. Well, the next is your culture. Let's read this passage. Jacob settled in the land where his father had lived as an alien, the land of Canaan. This is the story of the family of Jacob. Joseph, being 17 years old, was shepherding the flock with his brothers. So here we see in the story of Joseph, they were living in a foreign land in Canaan. We see that they were shepherds, and Joseph was tending the flock, and that was his main responsibility at 17 years old. But his main identity, culturally wise, was that he was part of a nomadic culture of the Hebrews. What about yourself? The language you speak, the language you spoke when you were born, the type of food that you like, the type of area where you grew up in. Did you grow up in Southern California, or did you grow up in Alaska where the weather would be quite different? All these things are part of our culture, and how we adopted to the culture of where we live affects us today as well. So that is also part of our story. How do we tell the story about our own culture? Next is faith tradition. Again, reading from Genesis. A young Hebrew was there with us, a servant of the captain of the guard. This was the cupbearer talking to the Pharaoh. When we told him, he interpreted our dreams to us, giving us an interpretation to each according to his dream. As he interpreted to us, so it turned out, I was restored to my office and the baker was hanged. And we can see throughout the story of Joseph, when he ended up in Egypt, how he's referred to as a Hebrew. Even Potiphar's wife referred to him as a Hebrew. Somehow he was able to keep his identity as a faithful Jewish follower of God, even within the various religious traditions in Egypt. So our faith tradition has a great impact on us as well. I'm always amused when parents tell me, oh, we're not going to take our children to church or to a synagogue or wherever it may be. We're going to let them decide for themselves when they grow up. Well, the end result of that is that, yeah, they will decide for themselves. They'll adopt to the wider culture in general, and not really have any faith tradition at all. So the importance of having a faith tradition when we think about our own upbringing, if you grew up in the church, for example, how that has imprinted your mind and your brain with experiences that you carry with you today and gives your life meaning and purpose. Well, here's an interesting one, the K through 12 brain. In other words, the brain that is growing and developing when we were young. Joseph had another dream and told it to his brothers, saying, look, I have had another dream. The sun, the moon, and the 11 stars were bowing down to me. But he told it to his father and to his brothers. His father rebuked him and said to him, what kind of dream is this that you have had? Shall we indeed come, and I and your mother and your brothers, and bow to the ground before you? So his brothers were jealous of him, but his father kept the matter in mind. Throughout his life, his ability to understand dreams impacted Joseph's experiences quite a lot. I want you to think for a minute of some of your favorite songs. Do you have any particular songs or music that you really love? My guess is that they are songs of your youth. In fact, they've done some research. They find that teenagers between the age of 12 and 17, that at that particular time in your brain development, that your brain seems to absorb all the music that is around you, and you carry those songs with you the rest of your life. So for me, it would be the Jackson 5, and it would be The Temptations and Diana Ross. Soul music is what I grew up with here in Southern California, John Muir High School. A little bit of the Carpenters. The Beatles were a little bit before my time. So those types of songs I still remember and probably can sing them to you today. So music is a good indication of those stories. And it's interesting, as people age, the older they get, the more they remember those stories of their youth. And they want to tell those stories, and they have very strong impressions about how they feel about themselves. So those stories that you remember from your high school years are still with you today and inform your story. Next is life experiences. Realizing that their father was dead, Joseph's brother said, "What if Joseph still bears a grudge against us and pays us back in full for all the wrong that we did to him?" So they approached Joseph, saying, "Your father gave this instruction before he died. Say to Joseph, I beg you, forgive the crime of your brothers and the wrong they did in harming you. Now, therefore, please forgive the crime of the servants of the God of your father." This part of the story of Joseph's life is very revealing. This happened after his father had died, and the brothers were worried about what he would do with them, because they remembered that experience, that life experience of when they took his robe away from him and faked his death and sold him into slavery. That story, that experience marked their whole lives, both the brothers and Joseph. It was a powerful thing that happened and affected their whole lives. So life experiences, experiences that you've had over the years, greatly impact your understanding and your story. Think about how the COVID-19 is affecting children today, when instead of going to school, they are staying home and looking at screens all day and not able to go out. Imagine the amount of fear they must feel, even with what is happening with government leaders and famous people who have come down with this, how they must have a fear. I wonder how this life experience is going to affect them as they grow up and as they look back on this pandemic. So the life experiences that you've had, is there one or a couple that stand out so strongly that they still impact you today? And how do you tell that story? Is it a story of overcoming something? Is it a story of bitterness? How do you tell those stories, especially those stories that may have had a negative impact on you today? And how you tell those stories has a great impact on the story you tell to others right now. Then long-term relationships. But Joseph said to them, "Do not be afraid. Am I in the place of God? Even though you intend to harm me, God intended it for good, in order to preserve a numerous people, as he's doing today. So have no fear. I myself will provide for you and your little ones." In this way, he reassured them, speaking kindly to them. Here we see the relationships that they had over the years conquered the life experience that had impacted them so much. Who are those people who are connected with you today? The long-term relationships. Maybe it's parents or siblings or cousins or aunts or uncles, other people in your life. Maybe it's deep friendships that you've had. I know for me, as I look at my mom's life, one of the things that greatly helped her throughout her life was the deep relationship she had with her friends at church. It was amazing how that group of women primarily stayed together for over 40 years, how they had helped raise their children together, how they had interacted over the years and had sustained each other even in their old age. They had the gift of those long-term relationships that sustained them for many, many years. So as we look at all of these, we see how each one of these has an impact in our story, our birth family, our culture, our faith traditions, our experiences when we were young, the K-12 brain, our life experiences, and our long-term relationships. So what do we do with that? What do we do with all these things that we've been learning about over the last number of weeks as we've taken a look at this idea of transitioning in our life, moving from one place to another, and how the power of a story can have such a great transformation for us? Well, what is it that we can do? Is we can tell our story. First, to yourself. What is the audio track in your brain? What is your own little voice saying to you on a regular basis? Is it saying to you, oh, look how well you've done. Look at all the wonderful things that are around you. Or do you look around you and say, oh, I wish I would have done that or done this. My life would have been much better. Or do you have a sense of anger about what has happened to you over your life? The things that you say to yourself and the way that you talk to yourself have a great impact on how you feel about life and the stories that you tell to others. What are the stories you tell to your loved ones? How do you explain to those in your family about the experiences you've had over your life and how they've shaped you to become the person that you are today? And what about the stories you tell to others? What is it that you tell them, even in terms of your own life circumstances right now? And then fundamentally, what is the story you tell to God? How do you approach God in your prayers, in your understanding of yourself and your life circumstances? How do you ask for forgiveness and guidance from God as you look and tell about your story? Well, let me give Filer the last word on this. He says, on a fundamental level, our life story has no inherent meaning. We must give it meaning. Just as we must give our lives meaning and our stories meaning, we must give our life stories meaning. Each of our lives is a life story project of its own. So what is he telling us? He's saying is, listen to the story of your life and tell that story in ways that gives it meaning and purpose. I think another thing that's inherent in that statement is that each of us has a reason to be here on this earth. God has created us for some reason, for some purpose. And to claim that purpose gives us hope and meaning this day. Let us join together in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And let's listen to our song from Angel and Michael.